born a new hope. And we stand up for our opening song, I Will Trust in the Lord.
I will trust in the Lord. I will trust in the Lord. I will trust in the Lord until I die. I will trust in the Lord. I will trust in the Lord. I will trust in the Lord until I die.
Church, help me sing that again.
I will trust in the Lord. I will trust in the Lord. I will trust in the Lord until I die. I will trust in the Lord. I will trust in the Lord. I will trust in the Lord until I die.
I will stay on the battlefield.
I'm going to stay on the battlefield. I'm going to stay on the battlefield. I am going to stay on the battlefield until I die. I'm going to stay on the battlefield. I'm going to stay on the battlefield. I'm going to stay on the battlefield until I die.
My grandma used to say this:
I'm gonna seek God for myself. I'm gonna seek God for myself. I'm gonna seek God for myself until I die. I'm gonna seek God for myself. I'm gonna seek God for myself. I'm gonna seek God for myself until I die. Treat everybody right. I'm gonna treat everybody right. I'm gonna treat everybody right until I die. I'm gonna treat everybody right. I'm gonna treat everybody right. I'm gonna treat everybody right until I die. In the Lord, I will trust in the Lord until I die.
Amen. Ain't nothing else to do but to trust in the Lord. Shall we put our trust in other than the God of creation? Amen. God bless you. How blessed we are to be here once again. Amen. On this beautiful Mother's Day, we salute all mothers. Amen. Those that are alive and those that have gone on to be with the Lord. Amen. We thank God for you, and thank God for your contribution for the world and for giving life. Amen. Let's give all the mothers a great big God bless you. Amen. Amen. We have much to accomplish today. Amen. Good to see Sister Clara here today. Amen. God bless you. And Sister Noble is here. Amen. So we have a full agenda today, and we're going to do what we can to conserve the time. Amen. We want our time here today to be fruitful, enriching, and rewarding. Amen. Amen. God bless you. To all of you that are with us online, we greet you in the matchless name of Jesus the Christ, and we welcome you on this beautiful Mother's Day, and we pray that all is well with you. You are experiencing the New Hope First Baptist Church virtual worship emanating from 705 Nelson Street here in the city of Greenville, Mississippi. And I pray that while you're with us online, that you will use our various means of our online giving, namely our online giving and our various platforms, that you will be able to share in the worship experience. Giving is a part of worship, and worship is a part of giving. And while you're there, I pray that you will share this worship with a friend, with a loved one around the globe, that they too can be enriched and blessed as we are today to be in a part of this worship experience. God bless you and God keep you. And we are praying that God's best will be with you. And while you're with us today, if you feel the need that you want to become connected with this ministry, you can let us know by typing in your name, your number in the chat, or calling our church, and we will rejoice with you in the great things of our great God. Again, God bless you, and may God forever keep you.
Hopefully, we all appreciate what you've done. See, I had to stand by the river and watch the ship sail away with my mother. But the love went with her and is still here. Hopefully, your children feel the same way that I feel. God bless these women of this world. Continue to make them the leaders that they are. Oh, bless our church family. Bless our minister, our deacons, our deaconess. Bless our nurse, our ushers and all that comes here. Put your hand on their shoulders this morning, Heavenly Father, and bless them. I want to say a special prayer for my friend Archie, that he can continue to improve and become the man that he were when I first met him. He's a statue of pure pride. I love him. Continue to bless all of us. Continue to keep all of us. And I'm not going to keep you all day. I'm going to say amen.
Get everybody to clap your hands like this. Stand up on your feet and help us out if you want to.
Can we have some old church for a minute? If we can have some old church, can you say yeah? I remember sitting in the back seat. My grandma, she used to be, a few years ago, she used to be on the radio every Sunday morning. Texella Fields used to be on the radio every Sunday morning. 94 Bad, that was my grandma. And when I was in the back seat, when she get out the radio station, when Big Jock let her go, she'll sit in the front seat and she'll sing something like this. I remember that song about 17 years ago. She'll start it off like this, y'all. Here we go. Don't let the devil ride. Well, don't let the devil ride. If you let him ride, he'll wanna drive. Don't let him ride. Y'all remember that? Can I sing it again? Don't let him drive your car. Wow, don't let him drive your car. If the old preacher said this, if he drive your car, you won't get far. Don't let him ride. Can you put your hands together? You know what? Don't let the devil ride. Sometimes it'll get real good, and grandma, she'll say, don't let the devil ride. If you let him ride, he'll wanna drive. Don't let him ride. Can you just wave your hands in the air and tell God thank you? Don't do it, don't do it, don't do it. Sing it with me.
Don't do it, don't do it, don't do it.
Don't do it, don't do it, don't do it.
Don't do it, don't do it, don't do it.
Don't do it, don't do it, don't do it.
Don't do it, don't do it.
If you let him ride, he wanna drive. Don't let him ride. Thank you, everybody.
Amen. Let's give my brother a hand of praise. Amen. Amen. I don't know why it took him so long to spring that one on us. Amen. Amen. We knew he was talented, but we didn't know he was that talented. Amen. Let's give him another round. Amen. 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 Thank God. We're certainly in the midst of a great time today. Amen. When you get home, you can tell you missed it. Amen. Amen. We had something extra today. Amen. Thank God. Thank God. Amen. We're going to move right along. And you know, today is Mother's Day. And we will have our Mother's March. And we'll be depending on Sister Noble to lead us in that and to help us with that. But right now, our own Sister Wood has a presentation to make, and she will do that at this time. And let's give her a great big God bless you.
Always be ready, stay ready. And I didn't know if we were going to have the Mother's March or not. So I told him I had prepared a little something so we could still be represented from the deaconess. So he is calling me to do it also. First, why we celebrate Mother's Day. In 1907, Julia Ward and Anna Jarvis are credited with establishing the concept of Mother's Day in the USA for the second Sunday in May. And today, we honor your mother. Webster defines honor as high respect. In Exodus chapter 20, verse 12 says, honor thy father and thy mother, that thy days may be long upon the land which the Lord thy God gives thee. Now, it didn't just say honor her on this day and forget about the other 365 four days of the year. No, it should not be that way. For we have so much to thank and honor our mothers. Think about her example, her support, her counsel, her humility, her insight, her patience, her sacrifice, her faith, her hope, and most of all, her love. And I was reading in the paper, what I was reading on the internet the other day, where it says, the phone companies say more calls are made on Mother's Day than any other day of the year. Now, isn't that something? Abraham Lincoln said, and I quote, all that I am or ever hope to be, I owe it to my angel mother. And then another person said, God could not be everywhere, so he created mothers. Now we know he's everywhere. So from the deaconess ministry today, we would like to say Happy Mother's Day to all of the mothers. And we want you all to know that you are very special and you have an essential role in this world. Thank you.
Amen. Thank you, Sister Woods. We needed that. Amen. We needed that to remind us of how precious mothers are all across this globe. Amen. 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 we want to continue to pray for our membership and those that need a special touch from the Lord, and namely Brother Howell. And I have been in contact with his sister, and he has greatly improved. Amen. And he has been able to make contact with some of you, and we're grateful for that. And today we received a card from Sister Spencer, and she has registered that she is back home and she is continuing to improve. Amen. Amen. So we are grateful that God is still moving on our behalf. Amen. I'm sure that many of you mothers have received cards and calls from your children, and I'm sure you appreciate that. And Sister Kimma received a card from Sean, and I'm going to wait and see if I'm going to get me a card Father's Day. Amen. I get the mail, and I'll be checking, amen, to be sure that I get something, amen. You know, we fathers, we put out a lot of money and a lot of time with our children. Amen. But it seems like we just don't get the shout out and the accolades that you mothers get. And I ain't been able to figure that one out yet. And when the football players get drafted, amen, and they always say, hi, Mom, amen. Well, what about poor daddy? What about him? Amen. We know how it goes, so we've been able to kind of deal with it and weather the storm. It is what it is. Amen. Amen. God bless you. God keep you. And we will keep moving on. Amen. All right. We're going to have our offering now. Come on, ushers, and help us. Amen. And then Sister Noble is going to tell us how she wants us to do this. Amen.
There is power, so much power. There is power in the name of Jesus. Power, so much power. Power in his name. There is power.
We're going to ask everybody to please face the wall, and we would like to have everybody to march. Take one step for your mother today. Even if you, and contribute whatever you have in your pocket to do so. Somebody say, if you can. Now, I'm not as fast as I was when the last time I was marching. So I'm a bit, but I'm going to be creeping behind me. So, pastors, I want you to do the same thing you've been doing the whole time. Thank you so very much.
Amen. Thank you, Sister Noble. Amen. We're going to stand, and I'm going to march out this way, and y'all do what y'all going to do. Amen. Amen. Give us a little marching. Shouldn't get rid of. Amen. Amen. You get rid of all of your traditional things. You forget about where you've been. Amen. Amen. God bless you. God keep you. Let's stand for Amazing Grace. Yeah. we come before you today, we are thankful for this, another worship. Thankful to you for these, your people that have gathered here in this place. Thank you for those that are worshiping virtually. And we pray that all that we do and say will bring honor and glory to your name. We're grateful to you for your manifold blessings on our lives, that you woke us up this morning, that you started us on our way. And we beheld a brand new day, a day that's been coming ever since creation. And when the sun goes down, we'll never see it again. But Lord, we are thankful to you for your love, and we are thankful for Jesus. Thank you for your Holy Spirit. And most of all, we'll thank you for the guiding principles of your word. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. I ask it all in Jesus' wonderful name we pray. Amen and amen. Amen. God bless you. Thank you for marching. Thank you for your contribution to the Mother's March. Amen. I tried to get my march in. I was a little stiff. Amen. From our little excursion there with Sister Kimmel and I, we did a lot of walking, amen. And we're still a little stiff, amen. So you can understand that, can't you? Amen. God bless you and forever keep you. I want to ask you to turn your attention to the book of Kings, 2 Kings, 2 Kings. The fourth chapter, 2 Kings, the fourth chapter. Amen. And I'm going to start reading at verse 12. Now, this is a long pericope. Amen. And it goes all the way to verse 37. I'm not going to read 37 verses. Amen. I'm going to read only a portion of it, and I would that you would read the remaining of it in your spare time and in your leisure. Amen. Amen. Starting at verse 12. And he said to Gehazi, his servant, call this Shunammite. And when he had called her, she stood before him and said unto him, say now unto her, behold, thou hast been careful for us with all this care. What is to be done for thee? Wouldest thou be spoken for to the king or to the captain of the host? And she answered, I dwell among mine own people. And he said, what then is to be done for her? And Gehazi answered, verily, she hath no child, and her husband is old. And he said, call her. And when he had called her, she stood in the door. And he said, about this season, according to the time of life, thou shalt embrace a son. And she said, nay, my lord, thou man of God, do not lie unto thine handmaid. And the woman conceived and bare a son at that season that Elisha had said unto her according to the time of life. Amen. I want to talk about a mother's surprise beginning and a happy ending. A mother's surprise beginning and a happy ending. Here we are again. It's Mother's Day, a day that we all love, a day that we call our attention to the wonderful contribution of motherhood. Now, there are various categories of motherhood. There is the biological mother, the foster mother, the stepmother, the bonus mother, the single mother, and of course, you can't leave out grandmother. They are the special ones in all of our hearts. For after all, mother is the executive chef in the kitchen. Mother is the taxi driver that takes the children and the grandchildren wherever they want to go. Mother is the doctor when things start hurting. Mother is the counselor when the children can't seem to have the right advice. She's a lawyer when we get in trouble, a guide to our great God. And last but not least, she's the psychologist when we get all mixed up and can't figure it out. Motherhood is a precious thing in all of our lives. Aren't you grateful for mother? The text before us, Christian friends, takes us to the home of a Shunammite woman. The Bible says she was a great woman. Anytime you see a great woman or a great man in the Bible, it means that they are wealthy. This was a wealthy woman. She was rich. She's a person who's kind, and she is a younger woman who's married to an older man. The Bible says that he was an old man. And much to her surprise, there are several things that take place in her life. She is and takes great interest in showing kindness to the prophet Elisha. She is a woman of great hospitality. I know of no godly mother that is not and has not been one who is a great host. Most mothers, whenever you come to the house, they always say, "Can I get you something? Can I get you something to drink? Would you like something to eat?" This was the type of woman and person that she was. She takes great interest in Elisha and the servant Gehazi. And not only does she take great interest and love and care for the man of God and his servant, but she goes to the extent of building a penthouse on the top of a house, so that whenever the preacher would come by, she would have a place that was prepared for him and his servant. And the Bible says that not only did she build this penthouse on top of a house, but that she furnished it. She had a bed, she had a chair, and she had a lamp. So that whenever the man of God needed to do some reading, or whatever he needed to do, everything was right there at his fingertips. So whenever the prophet came to town, this is where he stopped by, and this is where he hung out. And I believe that there was so much love in this place that it was a home away from home. Yes. Now, when you really look carefully at the text,
you will find that not only did she have a home, but she also had a second home. She had a second home with what we would call a vacation home. She had another home back home with her people. So you see, this woman had her own condominium back home. She was a wealthy woman, but she was a woman full of grace. She was a woman full of love, and she was a woman that did not mind sharing. Now, regardless of your financial situation, if you are a person of means, it should not take away your love and your kindness for other people. This woman's wealth did not change her attitude about other people. She really demonstrated how all of us should exhibit love and kindness toward others. Here we find the prophet of God was so overwhelmed by what she had done. Can you imagine the expense that would have gone into building and extending the house that she lived in and building a penthouse, and the expense that would be involved in that? And Elisha said to his servant, this woman has done a wonderful thing, and we ought to do something for her. And she ought to be rewarded for what she has done. And I want you to know today that whatever you do for the kingdom of God, and men and women that serve in the kingdom of God, you will be rewarded. So the servant said to Elisha, well, she does not have a son. And this was a very challenging thing in the East. You see, even though she was a woman of wealth, every woman had a desire to have a son. Well, why would that be so significant? And why would that be so important? You see, in the East, it was understood that whenever a parent became aged, that the son would take care of the parent. You see, there's no such thing as Social Security. There's no such thing as a pension, or a widow's pension. There's no such thing as a nursing home, you see. So a mother would depend upon a son to take care of them in their declining years. And then if a mother did not have children, that was considered to be a shame. It was considered to be something like a curse. So every woman had a desire to have a child. But the most unusual thing about the text is this woman, in all of her desire, she never asked Elisha for anything. You know, some people, you know, if they can get close enough to you, they think they got, you know, they think they really, you know, you owe them something. You know, if you get real close to, you know, they get real close to you, you know, they stopping by the house all the time, they eating your food and everything, you know. So, you know, you pretty cool with them, you know. So if you pretty cool with them, then you kind of ease up to them and say, you know, I need you to do such and such a thing for me, you know, because you tight with them. But this woman, regardless of her relationship with Elisha, she did not exploit that relationship. She did not use that relationship to get what she wanted out of it. You know, some people, they won't do nothing unless they get something out of it. You see, when you look at the life of Mary and Martha, and when Lazarus died, you know, they sent for the Lord, and because they were so tight with him, and, you know, he spent his time there in Bethany, they really thought that he was going to come running to their rescue because they were so close to him. You see? But in this case, the woman did not use her relationship to exploit the relationship, which teaches us we should not be in the business of using people. We should not be in the business of using people. You see, motherhood is really almost going out of style. I said motherhood is just about going out of style. Well, why would you say that? Well, if you talk to educators today, they have a problem because the population of students is on a decline. Schools are consolidating. They are closing schools. They have more teachers than they have students. So motherhood is on a decline. You see, women today, they can do pretty much whatever a man can do. You see, back in the day, you know, a woman looked to get married for security. That's not happening today. You see, in most instances, the woman is making more money than the man. So some women have the mindset that what I need a man for? Well, what I need a man for? I can buy whatever I want to buy. I can go wherever I want to go. I can do whatever I want to do. I ain't running after them. They running after me. So you see, the mindset of the culture today makes motherhood be on a decline. If you pick up your local newspaper, how many times do you see there's a wedding notice in the paper? That tells you something, doesn't it? Well, when we look at the life of this woman, first of all, I want you to see the prophecy. The prophecy is that this time next year, you're going to have a son. Well, you got to understand now, her husband is old. And the possibility of her becoming pregnant and to conceive a child is very far-fetched from the natural. But when God steps in, the supernatural takes place. So she says to the man of God, in our own word, now don't play with me now. Don't play with me. What you say? Do you know how old my husband is? Now, if you had been in that same situation, you would have said the same thing. But the record is that it came to pass just as the man of God said. Well, what do we learn from this text? We learn from this text that shows us that wherever we are in life, this time next year, your situation can change. Why don't you shout on that? At this time next year, your whole situation can change. Even if you are single out there, and you desire to be married. According to this text, when God steps in, your whole situation can change. Why don't you say amen? You may be struggling with your bills today. But this time next year, your whole situation can change. That ought to give you some hope today. That ought to just make you be encouraged today. You may not be in the job that you want to be in today, but this time next year, your whole situation can change. Your whole situation can change. You see, there are many people that are giving up today because they don't see how their situation can change. But it can change. It can change when God speaks into your life. And when you have faith in God. Look at the text. She's facing an impossibility. But yet the man of God says, this time next year, you will have a son. What are you trying to give birth to today? What are you trying to give birth to? What are you trying to call into existence in your life? It will come to pass if you have faith in God. Secondly, the text teaches us that our tears will turn into joy. You know, I don't know about you, sometimes I cry. I cry over my children. I cry over situations. And if you're fair with me, you cry as well. You cry. Why am I going through this? I have been faithful, Lord. I have done what you have told me to do, and I've gone beyond. Why am I going through this? I know you've asked the Lord that. Why am I sick? Why am I suffering? Why did you let this happen to me? You know I depended on this. You know how much joy this gave me. And we ask God why. But sometimes the Lord takes away the crutch that we've been leaning on to show that I'm more than enough to hold you up. Hallelujah for the Lamb. Yes, he says to us, your tears will turn into joy. Oh, yes. God will settle your case. Oh, yes, he will. Everybody in here has got a case to be solved. But God will settle your case. Well, there are several reasons why people settle cases, Brother Buck. Well, first of all, you settle a case when it's so much against you. And you want to cut your losses. Yeah, you want to cut your losses there. And secondly, when you sell the case, you already know what the outcome is going to be. You see, if you go to court and you're waiting on the jury to decide, it may go with you and it may go against you. But when you settle something, you already know what the outcome is going to be. You see, this woman, she already knew what the outcome was going to be because the prophet had already told her. And then another reason you might want to settle is because it will give you peace of mind. You won't have to worry about it. You won't have to worry how it's going to turn. If it's going to turn this way, if it's going to turn that way. But if you settle it, then you already know the outcome. Yes, yes. And then my last point to you is that God is so merciful, and what money cannot buy, God's grace will give you. What money cannot buy, God's grace will give you. If you try to buy everything you want, you ain't gonna never have a thing. You ought to let God give you some things that you didn't work for, that you didn't expect. You see, this woman, she wasn't expecting a son, but God gave her what she wasn't expecting. She didn't have to work for it. She didn't have to struggle for it. The Lord just gave it to her. And there are a lot of things that I enjoy today. I didn't work for it. You didn't work for it. The Lord just gave it to you. And you and I are walking around acting like we did it. No, you didn't. You didn't do it. The Lord just gave it to you. Yes, he did. There are a whole lot of folk worked on the same job that you worked on, and they ain't got near as much stuff as you got. And they wondering, how in the world did you do it? And the way you did it was God did it. Hallelujah for the Lamb. Oh, yeah, but then not only do we see a hospitality, not only do we see that, but also we see her heritage in a son, but we also see her heartbreak. She has a heartbreak here. The son comes and is born, and the Bible says he grew and became grown. And somewhere he was out in the field working, and he starts to say and shout, my head, something happens to him. It could have been something hit him in the head. It could have been an aneurysm. But whatever is going on here, there's something that's going on in his head that eventually leads to a fatal death. And you know, you can think about it. This woman has a son, and then everything going good, and then all of a sudden you got this. So what's going on in her mind? She said, I'm going to go and see the man of God. And she puts this son and leaves him and takes him up to the penthouse and puts him in the bed of the preacher. That's what she does. Now, you're not going to see anywhere where she is discussing what she is doing with her husband. Now, we men got sense enough to know we tell you everything, but you don't tell us everything. Y'all got quiet on that one, didn't you? All right, she leaves, and she leaves the house, and her husband said, where are you going? It ain't the new moon, and it ain't the Sabbath day. And then she doesn't tell him anything. She just goes on and lets him know everything's all right, and she goes on to find the man of God. Oh, yeah, when she finds the man of God, then she begins to argue her case. Now listen. Now, you gave me a son. I ain't asked you for no son. I was doing fine. I got money. I got a house. I got a house back home. I'm doing fine. My husband is old, true enough, but I didn't ask you for no son. And that son you gave me, he dead. And I wouldn't have to go through all this stuff if you hadn't given him to me. That's what she said. You don't believe it. When you get home, just read it. And so while she's standing there, she's arguing her case, she's upset, and you got to understand why she's upset. I got this problem, and I didn't ask for this problem. But isn't it true? We have a lot of problems in our lives that we didn't ask for. Sometimes we can end up with somebody else's problem. But yet, if it's your problem, God gave it to you to work it out. Why don't you say amen?
Amen.
So, Elisha's standing there trying to figure out, now, what do I need to do now? So, he sends his servant with his staff. And the servant goes ahead and he lays the staff on the boy who's dead. But the staff really represents Elisha's presence and anointing. But you see, it's not the fact that his presence and anointing in the staff didn't work or wouldn't work and didn't work. The fact is, this woman didn't put her faith in no staff. She put her faith in the man of God. So she says to Elisha, I don't want no staff on my son. I want you to come to my house. And if you come to my house, I know everything is going to be all right. Why don't you say amen today? So Elisha makes his way to the house. And I'm almost through. He makes his way to the house, my brothers and my sisters. And when he gets to the house, there he finds the dead son lying on the bed. So what does he do? He decides that he's going to stretch out on him. He stretches out on him, and he lines up his body with eye to eye and hand to hand and feet to feet and heart to heart. He lines up. What's the message? We got to line up our lives with the word of God. Oh, Lord, I wish I had more time. So he lines himself up, but then the Bible says his body begins to get warm. So what he does after that, he gets up, comes from away from the penthouse and walks back downstairs and in the house, and he walks back and forth in the house. And while he's walking back, have you ever done that? Get up sometimes, you can't sleep at night, and you walk this way and you walk this way. Yeah, but anyway, he walks back and forth and he prays. And then he goes back up the stairs to the penthouse. And then he stretches out again. Yeah. And he lines his body up. And the Bible says that when he does, that the boy sneezes. He sneezes 7 times. You know, 7 is the number of completion. Why don't you say amen? When God show up, you got everything you need. And the Bible said when he sneezed that he came back to life. And the Bible says Elisha gave the boy back to the mother. Hallelujah for the Lamb. All I'm saying to you is that God is full of surprises. But thank God this story ended with a happy ending. But every time that we find ourselves in an unusual situation, God will show up and show out. Don't worry about the bad thing that can happen in your life, because I see God turning things around this time next year. God will give you a new lease on life. God will turn things around in your life. I don't know about you, but I'm leaning and depending on the Lord, because I know the Lord has got all power. He can do the impossible. And anybody in here ever tried him? My God, he is El Shaddai. He's Jehovah Nissi. He's the God of all power. Anybody in here love my Jesus? Ain't he all right? God has got all power. This woman had faith that if she waited on the Lord, that everything will be all right. I don't know about you, but I've been leaning and I've been rocking, but I'm waiting on the Lord to work out my situation. Don't let nobody fool you. Everybody in here got something that you're leaning and waiting on the Lord to work out. But I know that I know that I know that if I put my foot on a solid rock, this rock is Jesus, the Son of the living God. Jesus, my midnight rider. Jesus, the one that rocks me late in the midnight hour. Jesus, my all in all. Jesus, the one that can turn water into wine. Jesus, the one that can raise the dead. His name is Jesus, a name above every name. At the name of Jesus, demons get on the run. At the name of Jesus, blinded eyes come open. At the name of Jesus, a lad lunch can feed 5,000. Ain't it all right? I know it's all right. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We extend the invitation today. You can come by letter, Christian experience, or candidate for baptism. As we stand for the invitation, let's stand for the invitation. Amen.
For the Lord on my side, tell me, where would I be? Where would I be if it had not been for the Lord on my side? Tell me, where would I be? Where would He kept my enemies away. He let the sunshine through a cloudy day. He wrapped me in the cradle of his arms, because he knew I had been battered and scorned.
So if it had not been for the Lord on my side, tell me, where would I be? Where would I be? Amen. You have your seat. Amen. Amen. Let's have prayer.
Let us pray. Dear Lord, we come to you again, thanking you for allowing us to be in your house this morning, Lord. Dear Lord, thank you, Lord, for the worship, Lord, today, Lord. Dear Lord, as we prepare to partake, Lord, we want to remember and thank you for the sacrifice that was made for us, Lord. This is my prayer in your Son Jesus' name. Amen.
Sing that again.
Friends, this is one of the commandments and ordinances that Jesus left with the church. There are only two ordinances that the Lord left for the church, and it is baptism and the Lord's Supper. Some try to interject foot washing, but foot washing was only given to the disciples as an example of servanthood. It was never given to the church as an ordinance. The Lord says that as often as we do this, we will show forth his death and his suffering until he comes again. In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit, shall we eat and drink together. Come before you today to thank you and celebrate your goodness and your kindness. We ask your blessings upon all mothers that are here today and all wish to be mothers, and we pray your blessings and your unmerited favor on their land. Thank you for mothers that have gone to be with you. Thank you for their lives and for what they have meant to us and still meaning to us right now. Thank you for their teachings. Thank you for their guidance. Thank you for their love. And thank you for their faith in you to teach us who the true and the living God is. And now may the grace of God, sweet communion, and the fellowship of Jesus Christ be with us one and all till we meet again. Let's sing together.